When a lion and tiger died in British zoos, it offered scientists a rare chance to compare two iconic hunters.
I want to get in here and see what's really going on.
Oh, thank you.
A team of experts will find out if they're the same animal under different skins.
And here we have the danger zone.
Joy and Mark will investigate the anatomy of a kill.
This is a killing machine, and this is the business end.
Simon will trace the ancestors of the feline family.
It's hard to believe that they're descended from small weasel-like things that used to live in the trees.
And Richard Dawkins will reveal how cats evolved for stealth and speed.
They stalk, they sprint, they pounce.
All right, here we go. This has never been done before.
Join the team as they go deep inside the big cats. Is a defining feature of big cats that separates them from their smaller domestic cousins. The mystery of how and why they make this thunderous sound is one of the first things the dissection team will investigate. At the Royal Veterinary College outside London, this lion and tiger, who both died in zoos, are about to undergo a post-mortem in front of student vets. The team will use this opportunity to look under the skin of these mighty predators to reveal how they work. Biologist Tecumseh Fitch has a special interest in how animals produce sounds.
That larynx is going to be right near the surface.
Yeah, I can feel it here.
You can get it? Yeah.
He shares this obsession with the team's own vocal enthusiast, Joy Rydenburg.
Oh, thank you.
Joy rarely passes up the opportunity to investigate the larynx of a new animal. They're both trying to understand how big cats roar.
The anatomy of this animal is actually much more similar to that of a human being than it is to that of a domestic house cat. So while in most respects this animal is very similar to a pussycat at home, in this respect these big cats, the roaring cats like tigers and lions, are actually quite unique in a way that's very similar to that of our own vocal anatomy.
The domestic cat makes its purring sound by vibrating the vocal cords in its larynx, or voice box. The lion's larynx is much bigger, and it sits lower down the throat, just like ours.
The larynx is here. This is the top of the larynx right there.
Yeah.
Just to give you a sense, if you were holding a human voice box, mine would be about this big. Okay, so look at this thing.
They know that the larynx has to move a long way down from its normal position that's kind of up here where you can kind of see my Adam's apple here. But in a roaring animal like a lion, it pulls its larynx down with these strap muscles.
When a lion roars, it extends the vocal tract like a trombone slide, using muscles that pull the larynx towards the ribcage. Quite how the lion produces such an unusually loud, deep roar has never been fully understood. Tecumseh has seen similar anatomy in many other animals, but this is the first time he's looked down a lion's throat. To trace back the strap muscles, they are forced to cut through the ribcage.
I want to get in here and see what's really going on. Jesus, look at this. It just keeps going. I can't see how much further it goes. So here's the first rib, second rib. It's definitely below that. It looks like it may be between the second and the third rib.
Just what have you found?
The muscles that pull the larynx down are attached much deeper than I've ever seen in any other animal. And they seem to go halfway down into the chest.
I have never seen anything like this. All the animals I've dissected, these muscles attach at the top. They don't go all the way down.
Yeah, here it is. I can't believe this. We're making a scientific discovery on TV. That never happens, does it?
The guys are very excited at the moment because they have found what is essentially a new scientific discovery as far as they're concerned, which is about the fact that the larynx may be able to be pulled down by a lion far further down than they ever thought before, which makes this bigger distance between its nose, essentially, or its mouth, through to where the larynx is. And that means potentially making a much deeper, bigger, more impressive roar.
To fully understand these cats, the team will carry out field experiments and observe their behavior in the wild.
Whoa, that was really scary. He was right behind us. Right, it was right next to us.
Reckless boy.
Not being able to see him and to hear him that loudly right behind us was very scary. How far do you think that sound would carry?
Well, a human ear can hear it about 4 or 5 kilometers, depending on the terrain. So lions probably can hear it a bit further than 8, 9, 10 kilometers.
So when you hear this roar at night, you can't see who's making it. Basically, it sounds like a great big thing. And by pulling it just a little bit lower, it can sound that much bigger, that much more fearsome, and thus defend its territory that much more effectively, or perhaps attract mates that much more effectively. So it's a beautiful example of a gradualistic Darwinian adaptation where it looks like at least this individual lion has figured out a trick, a dirty trick to enable it to go even further than an ordinary mammal would.
The big cats evolved roars to help them defend large territories. So how would these lions react to the sound of an intruder? The team sets up a field experiment at Velgavanden Game Reserve to find out.
Watch this thing, it can smash fingers as it rotates.
We've got one of the male lions behind us in the road, and back behind us over there in a tree, we've set up some loudspeakers to play another male's roar, a roar from an intruder male that could be coming in here to try and take over his territory and see what happens.
Lion researcher Paul Funston has built up an impressive collection of roars from recordings in the wild.
So is it more of a stay away or more of an invitation, I want to challenge you?
I think it's primarily a stay away, but there's the second roar coming. But it's also a challenge. So the tape is set up to sort of simulate a typical bout with gaps every 3 to 4 minutes between each roar. Bout would normally comprise about an hour or so, telling the females that they're around and telling any other males in the area, you know, that if they did want to potentially have a conflict, that this is where they will be for the next hour and a bit.
They can make an appointment and come
visit
them?
Well, basically, they could make an appointment and come visit them, sure.
He just doesn't seem that bothered by this at all. And he looks over towards the speakers, but you know, he's not going over there to investigate, which could mean all kinds of things, lots of explanations potentially for it. Maybe because it doesn't sound to him like a real roar. It may be that he's just supremely cocky. And he goes, don't care. Of course, he could be deaf.
Perhaps there's another reason. He's one of two brothers guarding a rhinoceros carcass. A few days ago, this rhino was struck by lightning, and they've been feeding off it ever since. So he's probably reluctant to abandon a rather maggot-infested lunch.
So we're going to change the sound to a buffalo calf in distress, a prey call, and see if he is more motivated by hunger than defending his territory. Confused lion, because he's come all the way here. He's now trying to work out this kind of alien tripod arrangement that sits here.
So we know there's two lions out there, and they would be hearing the call of war.
So he's now making the contact call.
This call is to attract his coalition brother to see what's going on. It's one of 9 distinct sounds they use to communicate. Back in the dissection room, Tecunse wants to see the lion's larynx in action by trying to make the dead lion roar.
So you're just opening the trachea? Yeah?
Yep.
How optimistic are you that if we blow some air through here, we're going to actually get it to work?
I think there's about a 5% chance that this is going to work.
So pretty optimistic then. That's one big windpipe, though, isn't it?
Yeah, sure is.
Okay, so compressed air is what we're going to put through there, then?
Yeah, that's right.
Do you know what I mean? I like your confidence there.
Well, I'm just going to do a little test thing right now and to see. Okay.
That's vibrating. I can feel that vibrating.
Okay, this is looking pretty good. I think we have a chance.
12%?
I'll go to 20. All right, here we go. This has never been done before. Never will be done again. Yes! Okay. So now we're going to move the larynx back, so hopefully we'll be able to hear the roar getting deeper. Everybody hear the difference? That's... That works.
While Tecumseh continues work on the lion, the rest of the team starts to examine the tiger. Mark wants to find out more about the tiger's iconic skin pattern.
But it's interesting, isn't it? When you pull back the legs here, you go from, yes, you can imagine this being camouflaged within a jungle or kind of tree setting, but this, all this white, is like sticking up a huge great flag, isn't it? As soon as you start running to something, all you see just masses of white underneath. Is that not a bit of a giveaway?
But when they're still in the forest, you've got the dappled light coming through the trees, and you won't see the tiger. You could probably walk up to it and fall over it before it, you know, you'd notice it, because they just completely blend into the background. Whereas cats that live in open country like the lion tend to have uniform colored coats because that helps them blend into their environment better.
And the stripes, is that a relatively recent thing from an evolutionary point of view? Or?
Well, we don't really know. Some people think the striping pattern has evolved from a spotting pattern over time. And obviously, we haven't got skins from many, many thousands or hundreds of thousands of years ago.
Cats mimic their habitats with an impressive array of coats. But they have all evolved from a single ancestor. To trace the roots of the feline family, biologist Simon Watt has gone to a big cat rescue center in Florida.
Lions and tigers, like all cats, are members of a group of mammals called the carnivora, or flesh devourers. Here, kitty. It's hard to believe that they're descended from a group of mammals, small weasel-like things that used to live in the trees.
After the dinosaur extinction 65 million years ago, there were new opportunities for hungry predators. 2 key branches on the tree of life emerge. The dog-like animals, bears, seals, and true dogs. And the cat-like animals, meerkats, hyenas, and the true cats. The lion and tiger split apart about 4 million years ago. Yet surprisingly, they can still mate and have offspring. They've got living proof here.
Was it lunchtime? Oh, is this her? Wow. Is this Freckles?
This is Freckles.
This is a liger. It's a cross between a lion and a tiger. Its dad was a lion, its mum a tiger. I've never seen one of these before.
Come on.
And it's just weird.
Come on, sweetie.
You can see she's got stripes very, very like a tiger's, but that tawny colour is unmistakable. It's just like a lion. Even on her neck, she's got the beginnings of a mane. It's unbelievable.
Man-made hybrids like Freckles really shouldn't exist because lions and tigers never come together in the wild. But the fact that the two different species can still breed is testament to their shared big cat heritage. The tiger and the lion look very different from the outside. But how different are they, really? Once their skins have been removed, they are virtually indistinguishable, even to the experts.
Splendid. Well done.
Lions and tigers are the same under the skin. From Siberia to the savannah, the cat body plan is almost unchanged. An evolutionist like me loves to look at a group of animals which is just a sort of slight variation on a body plan. In the case of cats, we've got the small ones that hunt mice and birds, medium-sized ones like lynxes that hunt hares, and then large ones like lions that hunt antelopes, wildebeest. Unlike the dog family, like wolves, which chase down their prey, run down their prey over a long chase, cats are stealth hunters. They stalk. They sprint and pounce.
But whereas the tiger is a solitary hunter, lions hunt in groups. Both hunt over large territories.
When you come over a ridge like this, you get a real impression of just how vast this area is. One of the territories on the far side, about 65 square miles, that's 8 miles by 8 miles, controlled by just two males. Lions are brilliant hunters, but these animals have got to protect their territories because this is a massively important food resource. And this is classic, look at the little one at the back. The little calf, very vulnerable to a lion predator that will pick these off for lunch.
The first stage in the anatomy of the kill is the chase. The lion has massive muscles attached to free-floating shoulder blades that give it a long, powerful stride.
Got the edge of the scapula there. We can try and move that. So you've got, from here, it could move forwards. That's incredible. That's about 15 centimetres or more. I can move it. Look at that.
So that's just going to really increase that stride length that we were talking about.
Okay.
So if you can move that scapula, you're going to be able to stretch that foot that little bit further forward, be able to grab and catch their prey.
This free-floating forelimb is also why a cat's shoulder blade visibly protrudes when it stalks prey. Try doing this with your own arm, and you'll yank it out of its socket.
If you were jumping on a wildebeest or something, you'd need to be able to do that, and this muscle would help pull all this round to be able to grab it.
Yeah.
But I mean, through here, there are loads of individual muscle groups.
Yeah.
All of them end up connecting to this incredible network of tendons that go out to the digits.
Yeah, and you can see right down here that this muscle here is just running straight into the tendon.
So we've got one muscle there that mm-hmm. starts back here where it's attached.
Yeah.
As the muscle running down, then into tendon, and so that is...
It's all these ones just here, so that's going to extend and splay out the toes.
So I'm doing nothing now but holding its radius and ulna here, and then if I pull on this muscle and ulna tendons, that is the action it's doing. So when that muscle contracts, it looks like a tiny little muscle, it's doing that.
It's run, 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 kill. And that's all it needs to do with its forearms.
Story.
Nothing illustrates this better than this video clip from India of a tranquilizer darting expedition that missed its target. The victim lost 3 fingers, but he was lucky to escape with his life. When the rangers in this park dart lions, they leave nothing to chance.
One basic thing for tonight is safety first, please, everybody. At all times, stay within the confines of the vehicles. Do not stand up, because you'll single yourself out. These lions are going to be agitated, especially once the dart is in, that lioness is going
to
be...
They're darting a lioness to replace her radio collar to enable them to track her pride across the reserve. It will also allow Mark to take a much closer look at a living lion.
Any questions from your side?
No. Cool. Okay, let's get on with it.
Let's go and enjoy it.
To draw the pride of lions out of the bush, they tie a dead wildebeest to a tree.
bodies have come. Okay, go for it.
After a few minutes, the dart starts to take effect.
This collar, we want to make sure it stays in place. So if it's too tight, it'll stick on the side of the neck. Too loose, it'll come off the neck.
How long will this last?
Roughly about 18 months.
Okay. And it doesn't bother them at all. As soon as she's woken up from this, she had the one on before.
Doesn't seem to bother.
Doesn't care. No.
As a vet, Marcus handled plenty of domestic cats, but he's never been this close to a wild lion before. He should have an hour before it wakes up.
I mean, obviously anaesthetized, she's completely docile, but this is a killing machine, and this is the business end. We just want to be gentle with her eyes, but we can have a look at the tapetum lucidum, the reflection off that mirror inside the eye that helps amplify the light through the retina for seeing in very dim light conditions.
We'll have a look at the cause for
it. Good, Nick. Oh, they are colossal, aren't they? Absolutely colossal. And her dew claws.
Yep.
Okay. And these are the ones that they used to hang on. So if she was jumping on a zebra, for instance, she'd use that claw to just hook into the zebra and then hang her weight on it to bring it to the ground before then using these to be able to start grabbing on to kill. Enormous power. All this is muscle. In here is the radius and ulna, but all this is just solid, solid muscle. And if that hit you, I mean, that would knock you off your feet straight away, wouldn't it? Absolutely.
So what we have here is a nice soft pussycat paw. Looks very cuddly. But when this animal wants to, it pops out the switchblade. And here we have the danger zone. If we turn it around and look at the other side of the animal, we can see the anatomy involved in retracting a claw. If we pull on this muscle from the top, we see that the whole toe moves upward. From this position, we can pull it up, just like a marionette. And then we can also pull it down with this muscle's tendon, which is coming underneath the foot, and that pulls the toe down. And we can wiggle that finger back and forth, just like we wiggle our fingers back and forth. But what we can't do is take our nail and protract it out to make the claw stick out. Our nail is always stuck here. But if you hold this in tension, and at the same time pull from the muscle on the bottom, what happens is the claw protracts out. That's called protraction, when the claw sticks out like that. The natural rest position is here, in retraction. But when they want to stick it out, they have to pull on both of these muscles at the same time to cause the switchblade to pull out. And then you get this very long extension of that claw. And that's the weapon. That's unsheathing the sword for these guys.
It looks just like a human hand, doesn't it? All mammals, in fact all land vertebrates, have very similar hand, all descended from a common ancestor. What's happened is that the skeleton has remained the same, but what's changed is the shapes and the sizes, the relative proportions of the bones. A bat wing is also a hand. A mole's spade is also a hand. The skeleton's remained, but the bones have changed.
The big cat's paws, with their deadly claws, can bring down the largest prey. It's now they deliver their deadly, crushing bite. The final act in the anatomy of the kill.
This is the tiger.
What? Actually, I'm not sure now. What have
yeah,
we got?
This is the tiger.
That's a long one, yeah.
And okay, this is I've got the lion. This is the lion.
Yeah, so the similarities between these really big cats become really striking, and part of that is just about its size. People have debated quite a bit which one is larger, a lion or a tiger. The fact is, actually, they're about equivalent. The biggest tigers and the biggest lions are about the same. And you can really see that. It's quite striking. If we open up the jaws, it wouldn't be that different looking into the mouth of a lion and looking into the mouth of a tiger. Another very impressive and sadly extinct animal is the saber-toothed cat.
And this is the tiger.
Just look at the difference in the canines between these two animals. These, again, think about the killing bite that would be possible with a set of canines like this.
It's interesting that it restricts the gape of the mouth. Even though you can open the mouth quite a bit on the saber-toothed cat, the actual distance that's open between the ends of the canines on top and on the bottom is very tiny.
So
it's
if this
not
guy
very
tried
large
to get,
distance.
Tried to get Joy's arm, I want your arm. Even with the mouth open that far, could barely get in there. So it's probably more likely that he would do something like this. Right? Don't bite me. You know, a stabbing motion rather than a biting motion.
Whereas this one can easily get you.
Yes, this guy could, no could question. Get my arm.
When a lion closes its jaws around the windpipe of large prey, like a wildebeest, it will hold the bite for up to 10 minutes before its victim dies. Back in the field, the anesthetized lion has been out for almost an hour.
But teeth-wise, that's a pretty good mouth apart from those lesions on the tongue. You do get a sense of how rough this is, the grooming and stripping meat off. But muscles in this head to be able to kill and also to rip the pieces of meat that it needs to eat off the carcass, absolutely massive. If you try and lift this head, this is an enormous weight in here.
The thing that's really striking about this animal's head are these gigantic muscles, these vast muscles. On us, if you look on the side of your mouth, this thing is the equivalent of this muscle. This muscle on us also exists. It's this tiny little thing that you can kind of see tensing, but it's just a little sheet of muscle in comparison to this muscle.
The lion uses the huge power of the muscles in its head and in its jaws to be able to either direct these canine teeth as a killer bite through the top of the neck to break the spine, or can suffocate the animal by squeezing its windpipe from underneath its neck. Either way, prey animal ends up inside here.
But once he's down to the business of turning this prey into a meal, it goes into scissor mode. So these are these cutting teeth. These are called carnassials, and they basically are quite sharp. They have a sharp edge. So two blades are in close contact so that they're really rubbing up against one another and slice very neatly and very effectively through a piece of tissue. But you don't really want these making contact when you're making that killing bite. You don't want to have them run up against each other and perhaps even shatter the tooth.
If the sharp back teeth come into contact when a lion makes its powerful killing bite, the result would be a dental disaster. It's overcome this problem by evolving top and bottom jaws that are out of alignment as it bites. And when the lion needs to eat, the jaws slide against each other to slice like a pair of scissors. The anesthetized lioness is now ready for the antidote to wake her up. The team's going to return to the dead wildebeest used to lure away the other lions to see those carnassial teeth in action. It doesn't take long for a hungry male to arrive. But he senses something's wrong with this easy takeaway meal. He's right.
Look underneath his belly. You can see there's a ridge running underneath the belly there.
Mm-hmm.
There's a flap of skin called the lingual fold. And so basically that skin is folded in like this. And as the lion engorges, the skin folds open.
Oh.
So it allows the stomach to distend.
Wow.
So that's an adaptation for filling the belly to engorged. They can eat about 30% of their body weight in one sitting. So 50, 60 kilograms of meat.
To survive, big cats need other animals to satisfy their high-protein diet. In the African bush, every animal must extract energy from the food they eat. They've each evolved a different strategy. Lions may be at the top of the food chain, but are they the most efficient eaters? To find out, the team's going to conduct a rather smelly experiment.
Looks like we got some elephant poo right here. Okay, let's get a sample of this.
Joy is hot on the heels of the herbivores. Elephants eat more or less anything in their path. And what goes in determines what comes out. Giraffes, on the other hand, are fussy eaters, delicately stripping off only the freshest acacia leaves and producing droppings a rabbit would be proud of. Mark's drawn the short straw, the king of the carnivores. It eats only every few days and is reputed to produce some of the smelliest specimens in the bush.
That is absolutely perfect. Not only a magnificent sight of it walking past, but the fact that it chose to do a dump right there is just brilliant, because when it's gone, I can go and pick it up.
I could smell it from here.
That's not good. You get a nice big bit there. I think that's going to be plenty, David.
Yeah. Back at the lodge, they set up a dung lab. By burning the samples in a bomb calorimeter, they'll see how much heat they produce, an indication of how much energy each animal has extracted from its food.
Temperature is 2.57.
Okay, so in terms of energy of the food goes in compared to energy in the feces at the end of digestion, how are the test results coming out?
The wildebeest extracts about 40% of the energy ingested, compared to the zebra that extracts about 50%.
How does the lion sample compare?
Compared to the zebra and the wildebeest, it extracted about 60 to 70% of the energy from the meat, which is very effective.
That's incredibly high, very efficient.
The vegetarian diet requires large, labyrinthine guts, such as those found inside an elephant.
Can you stand back, please?
Yet they're surprisingly inefficient at extracting energy from their food. So what's the secret of the big cat's guts?
When you compare it with like a herbivore, which has an incredibly complicated digestive system, this actually is just very simple, isn't it? We've got stomach and a whole load of pipe work to do all the absorption and then to produce feces at the end. End of story.
Yeah, but because meat's so easy to digest, you don't need a very long tube to digest it in. So compared with a herbivore, this is a very, very short gut.
And that's a function of being so high up the food chain that your food is already pretty well processed from the difficult to digest stuff, which the herbivores have already done for you.
Lions spend most of the day sleeping after feasting on a kill. It seems like the perfect strategy. As meat eaters, lions let their prey's guts do the hard work of processing low-energy food. That way, the lion stays lean and mean, building up powerful muscle to hunt down their prey. But lions don't always have it their own way. Only 1 in 5 attacks is successful.
Lions and other cats are superb killing machines, but of course they don't always succeed. They don't always make a kill. Antelopes, or whatever their prey are also superb running away machines, superb escaping machines, but they don't always escape. That's exactly what you'd expect, that there would be some failures on both sides. And there's actually an additional reason why you might expect a slight imbalance in that evolutionary arms race. You can express it in the words of an Aesop's fable. The fox is running for its dinner, but the rabbit is running for its life.
So far, the team's investigations have revealed that under their skins, lions and tigers have virtually identical anatomy. But there are key differences that can't be understood by dissection. Tigers and most other cats lead solitary lives, whereas lions live in unique family groups. The team is now going to look at the anatomy of the pride. These family groups probably evolved to help lions take down large prey and to defend their territories. It's resulted in a complex hierarchy.
For some extreme turf wars between lions. We're flying over one territory now, held by a coalition of two huge, magnificent males. But the boundary between their territory and the next one is this valley down here and this river system. On the other side of that valley is another territory held by a coalition of two other younger males. And it really is the front line where the action goes on, because their territory is where they get their food and they get their mates to be able to reproduce.
The team is going back into the territory to try and find the pride they tracked on their darting foray.
About 2 o'clock, straight over here then.
The mother, whose collar was replaced last night, is back with her cubs. But as usual, the males are away on patrol. The males form bands of brothers who work together to defend their kingdom against rival males from the neighboring territory.
There, under the trees here. Stop there. There they are. There's our two males. They are the kings of this place. Absolutely awesome. God, look at the testicles on that. How does this guy fit into the male coalition and the whole pride?
He's the big male, as we call him, the Induna, or the boss around here, or main peanut in the packet, but he's the dominant male, and he'll actually mount the other male sometimes as a show of dominance over the other male.
Wow. And how old do you think he is?
He's roughly about 8 years old, so he's in prime of his life. But at this stage, he's separate from the pride, so I assume these two males are busy marking their territories. They're busy going around the entire boundary, making sure there's no other males in the area, quite often vocalizing a lot, telling other male lions that this would be their prime area, and marking territories by defecating and spraying their urine on bushes to mark their territory.
All cats spray urine as a form of territory marking, saying who's been where and when. And if we look at the anatomy, the big male cats have got a big advantage in terms of their penis and which direction it points. If we have a look here, I mean...
Let's reveal the King of the Jungle's crown jewels.
Actually, it's all very small. Isn't it?
It is very small, very compact. And normally, of course, it just sort of hangs down and points backwards quite naturally. And so when it wants to spray urine, it goes in the right direction.
Do you want to dissect down here a little bit? A lot of it's hidden round through the pelvis, isn't it?
Yeah, a lot of what would become engorged is actually hidden away there. And it's the shape of this thing when it's engorged which helps it push forward in the right direction for mating.
So normally, when it would be spraying, it would be kind of like that.
That's right, yeah.
As it gets engorged, it's then moving round into a position... like that for reproduction.
Yeah.
Successful dominant males will mate for 30 seconds every 30 minutes, sometimes for 4 consecutive days. They leave nothing to chance in their effort to ensure they pass on their genes. They know they may have to fight off younger males looking to start their own pride. Across the river on the other side, Mark is looking for the rival male coalition. He doesn't have far to look. They're still guarding the rhino carcass.
Is that the bark?
That was the bark.
Yeah.
Tail flitching, ears back. Just a slight warning. These are two young male lions. Two different mothers, but the same father, roughly about 5 years old. They've taken over this territory in the Southern Florida Reserve roughly about 2 months ago. As you can see, very young males. Manes looks like they haven't shaved for about 2 weeks. But up and coming, they're also starting to get a bit more dark. You can see the one's got a darker mane than the other. Normally that's a sign of dominance. The more darker the mane, the more dominant he is.
Yeah, I mean, it's interesting, there have been studies done where the darker mane is attractive to the females. They check it out first, so... It must have a really important role to play.
In a bizarre experiment carried out in the 90s, scientists introduced stuffed lions with different colored manes to see which one attracted the lionesses. Dark manes are a sign of increased testosterone. Even though they can't have smelled that convincing, the females were still attracted to the dark mane. And even this male approaches his stuffed rival cautiously.
And this is almost certainly a good example of what Darwin called sexual selection, as opposed to natural selection. Sexual selection means that males, in this case, are selected because of their success in out-reproducing rival males, often because they're more attractive to females, but sometimes because they're more intimidating to males.
Females need to choose the most dominant, dark-maned, testosterone-rich male for a very important reason.
In the cats, in the big cats in particular, there's a lot of male infanticide. If some intruding male comes in, pushes away the former dominant, the first thing he does is kills the babies, kills the young animals. So from the female's point of view, the last thing she wants is to invest all these resources in gestating a young, giving birth to her cub, and then at 3 months or 6 months, another male comes in and kills it. So what she wants is to ensure that she mates with a dominant male, with a powerful male that can keep the competition away. Therefore, she can have a pretty good chance that her cubs are going to make it to be old enough to avoid infanticide.
In the court of the Lion King, the young princes are initially vulnerable, until one day these young pretenders become strong enough to claim the throne. The team has uncovered how the biggest cats in the feline family have adapted their anatomy to become dominant males, and how their paws and jaws have turned them into such formidable hunters.
Our big cat dissection has shown that underneath, lions and tigers share the same basic body plan, even though they live very different lives. What's really impressed me, though, about spending a few days with these guys out in the wild is how, through evolution, they've developed a really effective social system ensuring the survival of their pride.
Long may these majestic beasts continue to rule supreme over their vast kingdoms. Back in her lab, Joy explores how our vocal anatomy compares to the big cats.
Lions can roar, they can growl, humans can talk, they can yell, they can sing, and it's all because we both have a voice box or a larynx. This is a specimen of a real human, and this is the spine, this is the soft palate, this is the tongue, and this is our star, the larynx. So I can actually put my finger into the larynx, and where my pinky is emerging down here is the windpipe, or trachea. So what I'm doing right now is actually cutting through the center of the larynx. Pulled this back. Okay, now we can see the vocal fold, and it's running back and forth across the airflow. And we notice that it's not a free cord. It's just a shelf of tissue that sticks out. So vocal fold is a better description than vocal cord. This tissue meets the one on the other side, which is right here. And when they come together, they make a bottleneck across the airway. And as they narrow that bottleneck, they vibrate, and that's where sound is made. This large space is able to be modified by the back of the tongue. The tongue can change the shape of that space and give us something that's really unique, vowel sounds. And that's why human speech is so much more complex than any other form of communication that other animals have.
This ability to speak and communicate complex ideas is key to the success of our species. We take it for granted, but every word we utter relies on tiny adjustments inside our throats. Joy's daughter, Ariella, has volunteered to have her larynx filmed in action.
So what we've got is a device that looks down the larynx by dropping down behind the back of the nose so we can look at the larynx from above.
Worst part is over, okay? Just great.
When Ariella makes a high note, you'll notice that the vocal folds are much tenser. They're closer together and they've been stretched.
And go high. And go low.
When she makes a lower note, there's more of a gap between them and they flutter more visibly.
Good. You want to do something funky? Doing with a beatbox?
Oh,
yeah, let's try that. Ready? And go.
So why do we love the larynx so much? It's a structure that sits in the middle of your throat, and it's probably the most important, least known structure in the human body.
Okay, that's fine, Ariel. Well done.
Ah, oh.
Tissue.
Everything I know about the larynx I owe to my dear friend and colleague, Jeff Lateman, who was actually my graduate school mentor.
The larynx is responsible for protecting the airway. If it doesn't work, you couldn't do a host of functions. You couldn't lift a heavy object. You couldn't go to the bathroom and poop if you were constipated. And a lady couldn't give birth to a baby without somebody helping. Think about this. The next time you're in the bathroom, you're on the bowl, and you have to poop, but you're constipated, what you have to do is close your vocal folds. Hey! Those folds are closed, and you're able to use intra-abdominal pressure to help nature do its duty, so to speak.
The larynx allows all mammals to control the flow of air from the lungs. What makes humans special is the range of sounds it allows us to create, all thanks to a remarkable transformation that happens in babies.
Baby humans are almost identical to all other mammals. Their larynx locks into the back of the nasal region. They have a direct airway, so a baby can be breathing at the same time it's swallowing, and it's why a baby can remain on its mother's breast. Now, something radical and amazing happens in humans. We're going to break this mammalian mold. The larynx is going to move away as the baby grows older. Physically, by the end of the second year, they've started to make more space. Think of it as going from a bugle to a trumpet. We get more tubing. The ability to increase sound production, particularly many vowels, is now shot up enormously.
You are watching the presentation.
We can now explore a new thing, and this is amazing. This gives us our ability for articulate speech. But there's a price. Nature always makes you pay. The next time you get a little piece of food in the wrong pipe, it's because the larynx has shifted and gone down. So you lose something with change, and you gain something with change. Obviously, in the course of our history, we've gained a lot.